Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents You Too. 25 voices share their hashtag MeToo stories. Edited by Janet Gurtler. Narrated by Allyson Ryan. Publisher's note: this audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type You Too into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page to access the supplemental content section. A list of public resources, including phone numbers and websites, is included in the bonus material. You Too? In 2018, hashtag MeToo stories began exploding across my social media feed, bringing back memories of the harassment I experienced as a young woman coming of age in the late 70s and early 80s. In addition to big hair and terrible clothing choices, I grew up believing that the women's movement had already happened. In North America, the pill had become legal for single women, in addition to those who were married. Many women were stepping out of the kitchen, beginning to make livings on their own. Gloria Steinem, a well-known feminist, was famously attributed with saying that women needed a man like a fish needed a bicycle, although she later clarified it was Irina Dunn who said it first. Glass ceilings for women were acknowledged, and sometimes, though not often, shattered. Helen Gurley Brown, the editor of Cosmopolitan magazine, wrote a book about women having it all, which fed the illusion that women could have it all, that they should. There was also an illusion that women were finally being treated equally to men. And yet, even in spite of all of this progression, I knowingly accepted less money because of my gender, and I was perfectly okay with it. I thought I didn't deserve to ask for more. I didn't want to ruffle feathers. So I listened to sexist jokes, racist jokes. When I was harassed, I was a good sport about it. And I didn't speak up. For years, I kept silent, learning to smile and play nice. But as more and more women came forward to tell their hashtag MeToo stories, a burning fire began to ignite within me, a fire fueled by anger and empathy, until one evening when I found myself ranting at my husband and teenage son at the dinner table, I finally realized how passionate I felt. I told them some of the things I went through as a teenager, knowing they couldn't possibly understand the scope of what happens to women all the time, or why this flood of hashtag MeToo stories made me so upset. As I shared my own stories, I discovered that my son truly believed his world was not one where women were still paid less than men, or were harassed for being women. To him, such injustice was a part of my lifetime, and his grandparents' lifetimes, something long past. I may have scoffed at him, perhaps not kindly. He didn't see the truth, not because he is a bad person or because he didn't want to see it, but because he had not been properly shown. I knew then that I needed to do a better job. As a mother, I needed to show him the truth about the world we live in. I needed to share my stories, and not just with my husband and son, but with anyone who would listen. That conversation with my son made me realize I wanted to take action. I wanted to share hashtag MeToo stories with other young people like him so they could see where we were and how far we still need to go to make this world a kinder, more just place for our children. I'm not an expert. I hold no degrees in psychology or human behavior. I can't offer professional help, and I acknowledge that. As a white woman, I am speaking from a place of privilege. I am also becoming one of the older generation now, and sometimes I use outdated terms and think in old ways. I've been called out and challenged to look at the things I say and think about how my wording might marginalize some groups of people. I often make mistakes, though I am trying to do better. But one thing I do know for certain is that we need to stand together. To protect each other, to amplify the voices of those who are so often robbed of their ability to speak. There are still many hashtag MeToo fights to be fought, and we need to fight them together. So I set out to collect stories from a diverse group of writers who were willing to share their personal encounters, stories that have now found a home within this book. There are a range of experiences here, though not nearly enough. There are many other stories to be heard from women and men, since harassment and abuse are certainly not exclusive to females. I've heard from men who were robbed of their virginity at an early age, by other men and by women. Men who were forced into sex because their physical response to stimulation was taken as consent. Men who feared talking about what happened to them or speaking about how much it affected and hurt them because they'd been taught that men should always want sex. We need to hear their truths, too. As you read the stories in this book, it will become obvious that the world is not a perfect place. Sometimes adults don't do the right thing. Sometimes the people who are supposed to love us and protect us can't or don't. And sometimes when someone tried to tell their story, others couldn't hear it or refused to. Some of the contributors worried that their stories weren't enough, that what happened to them wasn't as bad as what happened to others. But I believe all these stories are important. It's not easy to go back and relive our most painful memories, and it's even harder to expose them to strangers. And yet, here we are, sharing them with you. We have each done so for our own reasons, but mainly it's to keep important conversations going. We want to see things change. We want people to feel less alone. We want you to feel less alone. Maybe you believe you deserve the bad things that have happened to you. You don't. Maybe someone is blaming you, or maybe you're too afraid to tell. Maybe it feels like your problem is too small to worry about, or too big to do anything about. It's not. Please know, no matter what, you are not alone. If you have experienced harassment or abuse, you might find triggers. Rape, incest, exploitation. The hashtag MeToo stories you will read here are hard, but there are people and organizations out there who care and want to help. Please use the resources included in the bonus PDF if any of these stories upset you or if you've had similar experiences. Please reach out if you need support. And finally, respect yourself, but please also respect the people who are brave enough to share their stories. In some ways, telling our truths is like standing naked in front of the whole world. It's intimidating and uncomfortable, and we may feel weird talking about it after. But we need to keep talking. We need to keep listening. For that is the only way we'll be able to change the world. Janet. It's Our Secret. Patty Blount. Secrets. What word can conjure up more magic than this? Secrets are a little girl's stock and trade, guaranteed to make eyes light up with mischief or excitement. Secrets are a game you play to test the limits of trust and of loyalty. Secrets are whisper campaigns designed to include only a chosen few. And if you're one of the chosen, suddenly you're special. You're favored. You're it. Secrets are important in most little girls' lives. I think this is exactly why the neighbor told me, "It's our secret. If you tell anybody, then they'll want to play our tickle game too. It won't be special anymore." I was 5. I wanted to be special. I wanted to be the favorite. So I didn't tell. I didn't tell anybody that this man lay me down in the back of his work van, took my pants down, and touched me there. But that's not the only reason I didn't tell. I didn't tell because at age 5, I had no idea this was wrong. I grew up in the Queens neighborhood of Flushing, in a small garden apartment complex near Francis Lewis Boulevard. When I was little, we didn't have playdates. In the summer months, you just went outdoors after breakfast and played with whichever kids were out. We had no phones, no internet. We had bikes and imaginations and very little supervision. which meant we got into trouble often, but always the innocent kind. I wasn't allowed to cross any streets by myself, so I had to stay on our block. Riding bicycles was the preferred activity, but sometimes it was too hot to do that, so we'd look for shady spots. The best shady spot was in the garages under the building. There were three of them. Three two-car garages with stairway access to a specific apartment above. One of these garages was where our neighbor kept his work van. He was a house painter, so the van always had a bunch of paint cans smeared with drips in the back. He had two sons, the oldest of whom was the same age as me. 5. For the most part, I liked playing with this boy I'll call Billy. He had cool toys, like the cars we could sit inside and pedal around the garage, pretending we were racing. Billy also had a great imagination. He'd frequently make up games we could play, like Monster Tag. One day, when we were playing house, he said I should ask his dad to make my doll a cradle out of a box we found that was just the right size for a baby bed. So that's what I did. I took the box and the doll and went to the van where Billy's dad was loading those drippy paint cans. His clothes and hands were splattered with paint, too. I asked him if he could make a doll bed out of the box, and he said, "Sure, but first, I want to play with you, okay?" "Play with me? Sure." I nodded happily. "But it's a secret," he said. "You can't tell anybody, or they'll want to play, too." A secret? Oh, boy. He picked me up, set me on the floor of the van, pushed me back, and took off my pants. They were shorts, actually. I couldn't even tell you what color, but that's not important. He had a cigarette clamped in the corner of his mouth as he put his hand between my legs and rubbed. "Does that tickle? Does that feel good?" he asked. I wasn't entirely sure if it tickled or felt good. I was too busy thinking about the doll bed he was going to make me. After what felt like a long time passed, I said, "Can I go play house with Billy now?" He gave me a little pat on my leg, put my clothes back where they belonged, and lifted me up. "Remember, you can't tell anybody. This is our secret." Then he took out a tool from his pocket and began slicing through the cardboard box I'd given him, shaping it into the perfect bed for my doll. I was 5. I can't remember how many times this happened. And I can't answer this one burning question that still haunts me. Did his son know? Did Billy send me to his father knowing what he'd do to me? Was he a victim as well? Does he remember? I remember eventually seeing a pediatrician because it hurt every time I peed. I had an infection and had to take medicine that looked like M&Ms and turned my pee orange. Still, I kept the secret. I can't remember how long. But as I said, secrets are a form of currency to little girls. One night when my mother wasn't paying enough attention to me, I sang, "I've got a secret and I'm not telling." Oh boy, did that get her attention. So I told her all about the van and the paint and the tickle game and that it was supposed to be a secret. She went completely still. She asked me to say it again and again. For a moment, I worried I'd done something wrong, that telling my secret was wrong. Then my mother told me keeping the secret was what was wrong, but I didn't understand why. Finally, my mother collected herself and tucked me into bed, and I fell asleep, content once more, until later that night when she woke me up and took me to the living room. There were several men waiting for us, men I'd never seen before, and Billy's dad. He stood just inside the door, arms folded across his chest, scowl on his face. My mother said I had to tell the men in the living room everything I told her about the tickle game secret. I did, but I think I spent more time talking about the doll bed Billy's dad had made for me. Nobody laughed. Nobody even smiled. One of those men asked, "Are you lying? Are you pretending?" I shook my head and turned to Billy's dad, hoping he'd back me up. I didn't understand this was bad. I didn't know that he'd lie. I was 5. He lied. My mother told me to go back to bed. I obeyed, but stayed awake for a long time. I was crushed by the things I'd heard in that living room. He told them I bothered him, that I kept playing with his tools and his paint, and he threatened to spank me if I didn't get lost. That never happened. He lied. Later, there were lots of whispered arguments between my parents. I couldn't hear most of it, but I did hear this. Why was she playing in those garages in the first place? I remember baths, lots of baths, where I was scrubbed raw. There were many looks aimed at me, looks of accusation, blame, and even disgust. I felt wrong, guilty. I told my secret, and he lied. Billy and his family moved away in the middle of the night. You play right here where I can see you, my mother said after. But I want to ride my bike. No, you stay right here or you go to your room. So I stayed right in front of the door, bored out of my mind. Every time I went to the bathroom, she followed me, looked inside the bowl. My pee was orange for a long time. A few weeks later, I was playing with other friends while our moms chatted. One of the boys said, "Let's play hide and seek." Enthusiastically, I agreed. He began counting. I ran down the steps to the garage under the building, which was full of great hiding places. My mother chased me, demanded I never go down to the garage again. Our game of hide and seek never even got started. Brian, the boy who'd suggested it, wanted to know why we couldn't play in the garage anymore. His mom and my mom exchanged a glance. You know the one. It's a look that says, I have no idea how to explain this. So they didn't. But I did. I told Brian, they're mad at Billy's dad for tickling me down there. I pointed between my legs and both moms nearly passed out. Brian suddenly had to go home, and I was once again stuck in my room. You can't tell people about this ever, my mother said. Billy's dad did a bad thing, a very bad thing. We shouldn't talk about it because everyone will think it's your fault if you do. That made no sense to me, but I listened. I didn't talk about the tickle game. I didn't play as much as I used to. I never went down to the garages. I don't remember exactly when I learned that those men who came to see me were detectives. And I don't remember exactly when I realized that what happened wasn't just bad. It was unspeakable. Eventually, I began to understand. The word molested entered my vocabulary. I learned that the two detectives in our living room that night advised my parents not to press charges because I would then be made to testify, to tell a judge what Billy's father did. And because he lied, because he said it was just my imagination, the judge would probably believe him instead of me. So they opted to spare me the ordeal. Or were they just sparing themselves? Despite everything, I grew up fairly normal. Except I now have this terrible aversion to the smell of house paint and cigarettes, and a morbid fear of vans. I sometimes wonder how many other secrets Billy's father had. How many other kids did he molest? It's a hard question to answer because his crime is so unspeakable, but now I find myself troubled by an even harder question that we've never dared to ask aloud. How many kids could we have spared if we hadn't kept it a secret? Wishing on Silver Dollars, Jennifer Brown. Wow, I'll bet your nipples are as big as silver dollars, Michael proclaimed as he stood behind me in line at the diving board. He was not at all original in subject choice. By that time, at the ripe old age of barely 13, I had heard it all. I'll bet if you drop your pencil at your neck, it never hits the ground. I'll bet you could use those tits as a table. I'll bet you don't know what your feet look like. Or, even more embarrassingly, I'll bet you can't even see your... Well, you know where that's going. It wasn't only the swimming pool where I had to duck and dodge boys like Michael. The hallways of my junior high school during passing period were some of the most naked, fully clothed moments of my life. Boys' overtly sexual comments, often accompanied by accidental brushes, grabs, and gropes, were often the burden of early developing girls like me. It was a captive environment where neither fight nor flight seemed like a viable option. Our only choices were to wish we could crawl into a hole, or wish they would fall into a hole, or maybe the entire school would crumble into a hole, whatever it took to make it just stop happening. Maybe they were embarrassed by their own bodies and unattainable fantasies, or maybe they were looking to divert attention from themselves. Or maybe boys like Michael, who would publicly and loudly undress us, and deem us fit or unfit to be the subjects of a multitude of sexual acts, were just plain mean. Whatever their reasons, they passed the embarrassment on to us, a burdensome backpack to carry to our next class, and frantically try to empty before diving out into those hallways again in an hour. Knowing that in an hour, Michael, or one of his dozens of stand-ins, would be waiting to mentally and verbally undress us again. At least Michael was creative, I guess. He does remain the one and only person in my life to compare my body to currency, which is interesting in that it adds actual monetary value to my sexuality, which is a concept loaded for psychoanalytical review, but that's probably an essay for another day. His English teacher might have even been tempted to give him extra points for his use of simile in casual conversation. Comparison using like or as? A+, Michael. Except we hadn't been conversing. We weren't even friends. At the pool that day, I'd just been waiting in line for the diving board, and he just happened to be behind me. Well, he didn't just happen to be behind me. He just happened to be behind me and also thinking of how he could embarrass me in a sexually hilarious way. Comparison using like or as in a degrading and humiliating, not to mention completely unnecessary, comment just to get attention and pervy laughs from your buddies? Point deducted, Michael. You fail. I was, and still am, a curvy girl. And while Michael's comments was far from the first comment I'd heard about my body, it would also be far from the last. In fact, he was ushering in what would become years of torment, teasing, bullying, intimidation, and unwanted touching. I was kind of shy and definitely sexually unaware, and the attention that was repeatedly brought to my body and what someone built like me would surely want to do with it filled me with a profound shame. Shame. Fear that I had done something wrong. Fear that the people closest to me would find out what kids were saying to and about me. Fear that people would think less of me. Shame that is still my companion when I reminisce about the good old days, which I don't often do because they were not good, just super old. Shame is a mystifying and powerful beast. It's the natural byproduct of harassment. It's also the natural byproduct of bullying. Together, they are a 1-2 shame punch right in the temple. You developed early, you don't fight back, easy opponent, TKO. Even if your harasser eventually develops a conscience and feels responsibility for what they've done, they are only sharing the shame, not taking it from you. You own it now. It is part of you. Shame over being harassed is also ridiculous because I shouldn't have been ashamed of being a victim. Like nasty woman, I've been told, we should be proud to carry the label slut. I get the concept. I get the desire to take the power away from the insult by being happy to have it. But by gleefully accepting the gift of a label of any kind, aren't we still defining ourselves by our labeler's terms? Why should we change our paradigm to fit theirs? Even if by fit, we mean counteract. In doing so, we continue to give the power to our harassers. We continue to excuse their behavior by altering ours. Just because we say we're okay doesn't mean what they've done is okay. I shouldn't have been ashamed of my body. I shouldn't have been put in situations that made me feel less than just because other people felt the need to comment on me and my body in a sexual manner. And I especially shouldn't have been made to feel as though somehow I'd brought it on myself, that I'd wanted it, asked for it. You did this to yourself, curvy girl, by by allowing nature to happen. As a curvy girl, actually as a girl period, your body is up for grabs, sometimes literally, too many times verbally. What you must look like naked, what you must be willing to do, what you must be able to do are all subjects open for debate. You are leered at and laughed at and cut down for having no sense of humor if you react negatively. You are propositioned and suggested to. Your ass is smacked and nobody is the culprit. Books are knocked out of your hands in hopes that your shirt will gape when you bend over to pick them up. You're reported to be into kinks you've never even heard of. Your breasts are drive-by tweaked and grazed. You are desirable in a horrible way and expected to take that as a compliment. You can never trust if a boy is into you because he genuinely likes you, or if he's into you because he likes the idea of being able to tell people he got a handful of you. You can never trust walking in a crowd. You can never trust, well, you can never trust. You are simply a collection of parts, just hoping to get from destination to destination with a little bit of pride intact. When we think about sexual harassment, we may immediately conjure an image of the stereotypical, lecherous executive withholding jobs and raises in corner offices until someone gets on her knees under his desk. We may think about trading sexual favors for equality. Not true, by the way. The actual trade is favors for silence. There is nothing equal about it. But here's the thing. When you're mentally and verbally stripped, the favors turn into expectations. By God, they own the rights to those silver dollars because they saw them first. Try to hold on to them yourself. Try to defend from groping hands and groping words, and you become a bitch. And nobody likes a bitch. Tisk, tisk. From the moment puberty kicks in, we are taught by our little peer society that our bodies don't belong to us, that we don't have a right to self-respect. We are examined and evaluated and boiled down to things and pieces and acts. And we turn on each other. Everyone, keep looking at the well-developed girl in the corner so you don't notice my body. Sorry, well-developed girl in the corner. I feel bad for you. I really do, but I don't want to become you. I've got to look out for myself. I'm not actually much of a fighter. And back then, I was easily intimidated. I didn't want to make people mad at me. So I smiled, even laughed at jokes that degraded me. Said nothing, did nothing to protect myself. I even tried to see them as compliments. Maybe not exactly the compliment I was looking for, but beggars can't be choosers, you know. I absorbed the torment so I didn't anger my tormentors. I knew that doing so would only ramp up the harassment as they got even more followers on their side. All aboard the harassment train. First stop, girl with big boobs and a bad attitude. Second stop, girl who sleeps around. We know it's true because, I mean, look at that ass. Third stop, girl who wears too tight clothing. Fourth stop, girl who wouldn't put up with it if she didn't secretly like it. Fifth stop, girl I'll pretend to be falling in love with until I find out she won't sleep with me. Sixth stop, girl who will take my compliment as a compliment if she knows what's good for her, because I'm popular and she's not, and I will devastate her life if she doesn't. The saddest thing is my story isn't unique. I shudder to think how many of us are desperately yanking at the emergency stop lever to get off the harassment train, all while laughing at the jokes, ignoring the grabs, pretending it's okay because sticks and stones and all that rot. What a bullshit saying that is. How many of us have so many Me Too stories we have trouble choosing which one to talk about? How many of us never talk at all because hashtag me too has an ugly hashtag twin, hashtag shame too. By the time we even reach the point of vying for careers, we have lived with harassment for so long, we forget that it's there. We overlook it and ignore it and laugh along with it, and then carry our shame like an extra appendage and ask ourselves what we could have done differently to keep that from happening to us next time. Because if we know one thing for sure, we know there will be a next time. We have already spent our entire puberty under the thumbs of our superiors, understanding that if we want to survive in our social structure, we must smile prettily and act flattered that someone noticed us. We must happily accept our riches, one silver dollar at a time. Shame runs deep, but it also runs long. I don't like to talk about that time in my life because I don't like to think about it. I'm still carrying that damn backpack, and I will never dig out the ugliest items that have fallen to the bottom. It's just way too deep, and my arms are too short, and I can't reach them. I wish I could go back in time and walk those junior high hallways with my 13-year-old self. I wish I could counsel her. I would tell her, "You are not a collection of body parts. You do not have to put up with people saying that you are. You do not have to laugh along or stay silent or worry that you are doing something wrong. You have a right to sexual privacy. You have a right to body privacy. Damn it, you have a right to privacy." Back then, I wished someone had told me not to wear that particular swimsuit to the public pool, which was silly because the one-piece swimsuit showed absolutely nothing. And even if I had been wearing a wool turtleneck to the pool, Michael still would have seen those silver dollars. It wasn't about something I wore or something I did. It just wasn't. Now I wish something very different. I wish I hadn't felt like I had done something wrong by wearing the wrong thing. I wish I hadn't decided that his mortifying comment was my fault, something I had brought upon myself. I wish I hadn't felt like somehow I had done something that made it okay for a boy to loudly and publicly assess what my naked body might look like. I wish I hadn't just accepted that these kinds of comments were a girl's burden to bear. I wish I had refused to shoulder that backpack. More than anything, I wish someone had taught Michael better. This is how it ends. Tiffany Brownlee. I wish I could say that there was never a time in my life where I felt out of place or unwanted because of my race. But unfortunately for me, and many other people of color, I'm sure, that's not the case. I also wish I could say that I've never been sexually assaulted by someone. But again, for me, and far too many girls and women around the world, that is not the case. My story starts in San Diego, California, my birthplace and hometown. I'm not sure if you're aware of how many, few, black people lived in San Diego in the 90s and early 2000s. But to put it in perspective, let's just say that in all my elementary classes of 25 to 28 students, I was either the only black kid in the class or one of two or three. There weren't many of us, but as a child, that had absolutely no effect on how I felt about myself. As far as I was concerned, that was the norm, and I never questioned it. Except for one time when my mother was doing my hair. "Mom," I said as she twisted my hair into a poofy spiral and clamped a colorful clip on the ends to keep them from unraveling, "why don't I have hair like my doll?" Sitting snugly on a pink stool between her legs, I turned for her to finish the other side of my head, and I showed her my Barbie doll. "See?" I said, running my fingers through the doll's head of platinum blonde hair. "Her hair is so pretty, and mine so nappy." I wanted to say ugly, but deep down, I knew I didn't have ugly hair, just different hair. I never even have to comb Barbie's hair to get it soft or straight. It's just always like that. Oh, Tiffany, she frowned. You have pretty hair too, just like your dolls. Then why don't they make a lot of Barbies with skin and hair like mine? All of my friends have hair like Barbies, and all of my Barbies have hair like them. I'm the only one who doesn't. Even at 8 years old, I was more woke to the underrepresentation of Black culture in the real world than many people are today. Just because, Tiffany, was her reply. That's what she always said when she didn't have the answer to something, or when it was too deep a concept for me to fully grasp. I'm sure that just because bothered her more than she let on, but I was young. Too young to understand the realness lying just under the surface of that conversation. It's not that I was in denial about being different as I was growing up. I was very aware of the distinct differences between me and my white neighbors across the street or my Filipino neighbors next door. Yes, I was different, but the beauty of living in San Diego was that about half of the population was just like me, a minority. So, even though I was, for the most part, the lone Black girl in my classes at school, I wasn't alone in feeling that way. There were probably plenty of other girls of color asking their mothers the same question about Barbies as I was. In fact, the lack of other Black people in my area gave me the opportunity to make friends with so many children of other races. I had white friends, Black friends, Asian friends, Hispanic, Latino friends, Indian friends. I mean, the list could go on and on. And the cool thing was that even though we came from different places and had different facial features and spoke with different dialects and accents, we were friends. We liked to play on the jungle gym after school each day and visit the beach on weekends. I was just like them and they were just like me. And then, in the middle of my sixth grade year, my parents sat me and my siblings down to tell us something huge. We were moving. My dad was in the military, so I was used to moving around, but this was a different kind of relocation, and they made sure to clarify that we were moving out of state to New Orleans, Louisiana. On the outside, I acted as if I was as cool as a cucumber, but on the inside, I was angry and confused and sad. I'd lived in California my entire life, so relocating to the boot state, as I called it, was an earth-shattering revelation. My parents wanted me to be excited with them, but I couldn't bring myself to do it. I already had a lot on my plate. I was waiting for my womanly body parts to arrive, preparing for my first visit from Aunt Flo, and figuring out how to increase my popularity status for the next year, which involved joining several sports teams. I didn't have the mental capacity to focus on yet another move when there were so many other things going on inside of me. I put on a smile anyway. The decision had already been made, and nothing I said or did was going to change that. I was hit with a ton of major cultural changes when we arrived in New Orleans. The biggest change was that I went from being part of a minority race on the West Coast to being part of the majority in the South. For the first time, I was surrounded by tons of people who looked like me and had the potential to understand the challenges that came along with being Black. In California, few people understood my curly hair and the fact that I didn't get sunburned when I spent more than 15 minutes outside in direct sunlight. So while I missed California with all my heart, it was nice to be around people who shared similarities with me, people who understood me. My joy of being surrounded by people who looked like me was short-lived, though. When school started, reality hit hard. Because of my grades at my previous school, I was placed in a combination of regular education classes and honors classes. I was elated to be in the honors classes in Louisiana, but when I walked in on my first day, my excitement faded. Again, I was the only Black student in those classes. I can still feel the chills crawling up my back and the knots forming in my stomach when I strolled across the classroom to take my seat for the first time. The stares from the other kids in the class said it all. Why is a Black kid taking honors? Things didn't get any better in my regular education classes either. Some of the black kids in my classes turned up their noses at me and snickered to their friends as I walked by. Whenever I'd answer a question in class, they'd mock me, mimicking my speech pattern because I enunciated every sound and syllable perfectly and properly. I didn't understand it. I couldn't wrap my head around what their problem was with me. At lunch a few weeks later, I finally found out why they treated me as if I was an outcast, even though we both had the same shade of honey brown skin. After paying for my tray of food, I hesitated before choosing a seat. I hadn't made any real friends yet and was still sitting wherever there was an open spot at the time. That day, I tried to sit next to a group of black girls. As I put my tray down, a girl from the group tried to push it off the table. "Sorry," she said with a smirk, "this seat's taken." I was young and new to interpreting tone of voice and body language, so bravely I asked, "Oh, sorry, who's sitting here?" "Anyone but you, white girl. Find another seat." She turned back to her friends, who all simultaneously mimed flipping their hair over their shoulders before they burst into laughter. I didn't understand the joke, and I stood there a while longer, my food growing colder as I tried to figure it all out. Eventually, the girl turned back, rolling her eyes, and pushed my tray away from the table for the second time. "Look, I'm only going to say this once, white girl," she said, leaning in closer to me, her brown eyes locking on mine with a rich intensity. "We don't want you here. You may look like us, but you will never act like us. And I don't care where you go, but you can take your wannabe white ass and sit somewhere else." I headed to another table to eat, this one filled with mainly white students. But as I set my tray down, one of the boys at the table turned to me and pursed his lips in a disapproving way. "Hey," he said, "don't think that just because they don't want you that we do. Dr. King Jr. may have made it okay for you to go to school with us with his speech, but nothing's changed, nigger. Find another table." That word. To this day, that word burns a hole in my heart. Hearing it that day marked the first time I was ever made to feel inferior to another race. Yes, the Barbie conversation with my mom hinted at the idea that we, as a black race, were inferior to white people. The fact that society expected me to play with a doll that didn't represent what I looked like on the outside was a flashing neon sign foreshadowing the hidden racism I would have to endure as I grew older. But it wasn't until I heard someone call me a nigger that I actually felt like less of a person. Just because I was born with a little more melanin in my skin than some people would have liked. In that moment, I realized I was seriously on my own. Neither the white kids nor the black kids at my school wanted anything to do with me for no good reason at all. And as a kid who was so open and accepting of other races and people of different backgrounds, because that's how I was raised to be, I was completely blown away by their actions. What's so wrong with me? I thought to myself. But what I should have been asking was, what's wrong with them? And who taught them to see one race as superior to another? Sometimes I look back and I want to kick myself. Maybe I should have given them a piece of my mind, but I wasn't the kind of person who was comfortable verbalizing my feelings of hurt or disappointment. So rather than tell someone...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.